Well met, friends, and welcome back to this little show where I am your humble narrator, here to educate... Well met, friends. I am your humble narrator, Amanda, teller of tales of daring do and daring don't, here to entertain, amuse, and perhaps even educate. And in return, all I ask is that you stay a while and listen. So, when last we left our intrepid group of high elves and snow elves, I was dead. Quick recap. Santa has vanished. Santa is a wisp. Santa is also the spirit of generosity. Santa has vanished. We eventually find out that Santa has been taken by Persephone, goddess of spring, and part-time wife to Hades, lord of the undead. Well, lord of the dead, actually. Not undead. We'll get to that. So, we get to the point where we get back and everyone has gone for the last few days. Holy fuck, what the hell just happened? We died! We all died! Everyone's dead! Game over, man! Game over! Actually, I was the first to die. As it turns out, the wisp that was Santa is surprisingly powerful. So, he quickly zaps through all but two of the party. And, it was rather amusing because Eric painted this picture of this wisp that flies down this corridor between the throne room of Hades and the room in which he essentially imprisons Persephone. And so you have this wisp fly down there and it's zapping. It's flying in amongst these elves and zapping them and killing them. And by the end of it, there's two high elves left standing. And the next thing we know, he has flown back up the tunnel. Persephone has not awoken for some reason, and he sinks down into her chest, her eyes open for one moment. They are the bright, shining, the bright, glowing, shining yellow eyes of a goddess before they turn red. They're still glowing, but it's not as nice. Now, in this game world, wisps turn red when they're angry. It's a pretty standard trope in most role-playing games, and you know, energy-based beings changing color depending on how they're feeling makes a lot of sense, hence the red eyes. Persephone stroke Santa, I'm going to call her Persephone, and I'm also going to refer to her as her because in this universe the vessel to some degree shapes the nature of that inhabiting it. In other words, if you were to take a human soul and pour it into like a wolf, it would still be largely human, but it would very quickly become significantly wolf-like. So in this respect, Santa, wisps not having a gender, essentially becomes female. I should also point out that Eric, in the meantime, had thought again about whether to have Santa be Satan, and very nicely asked us all, please can we forget that? It was a stupid idea. We were all more than happy to forget that. So, Persephone is gone. And Hades wakes up. And Hades looks around his throne room. And there's dead elves. Well, there's like three dead elves everywhere. And two snow elves and one high elf in the air. The two surviving ones are standing there looking traumatized. What the hell has happened here? Why are you here? Where's my wife? Where? Yada, 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 yada. So, there's this really, really intense discussion between one of the surviving elves and Hades, where it's, oh, great and powerful Hades, lord of the underworld, enforcer and protector of the dead, we came from, and it goes on and on and on. It goes on for a good 10 minutes, and it's pretty good. I mean, we're not drunk at this stage, so it's still pretty good. And Hades goes, well, it's your responsibility to bring Persephone back. Find a way. Get out. And, you know, they're now trying to pick up these snow elves. And Hades decides, and you'll need help. So, because here's the thing. We died in the realm of Hades. We died in the realm of the dead. Can you actually die in the realm of the dead? It was a big question. The answer is kind of. You can die. But because you've never crossed the River Styx, it doesn't exactly stick as such. So he basically inserts our souls back into our bodies, when we very quickly are informed that you're back in your bodies, everything is great, except for the fact you can't touch, you can't feel anything you're touching. You can't smell, you can't taste, and you realize you're not breathing. That's right, we have zombie elves. Talk about Christmas at Ground Zero. So we eventually, we're at that point, we're kicked out of Hades, and Eric goes into this detailed description of us walking back through Elysium and how we're looking down, and the snow elves and the high elves that died feel this tug towards it, but aren't able to follow that tug. And in the next area, we see the realm of Tartarus, which is even more horrifying than it was. Apparently, Hades is making it quite clear that if we fail, that's where we're going to spend a lot of time. So we go through. Cerberus ignores us because we have the leave of the world, the Lord of Hades, the realm of Hades, the Lord of the realm of Hades. The ferryman takes us across without requesting extra payment. Great. Now, in between, we had stopped. But in between the play sessions, we had gotten together, the players had gotten together to plan out our response. Because we assumed that, like, my character was the only one that was going to be dead, and I was going to end up just basically watching. So we needed a plan. And boy, did we have a plan. Because the very next thing we asked was, can we have a 20-minute break while we figure out what we're doing? Oh, and what year is this? We're told that it is, I actually need to look at my notes one moment. This won't take very long. One second. There we go. We are informed that it is 1598. Now, this is a really important point. This is an alternate universe. It's an alternate history. But one of the key things in alternate history role-playing games is you try and keep specific people alive, because they give you a linchpin to turn the world around. Like Julius Caesar is a good one to keep alive, or Queen Victoria. Having that character who exists in reality and in the alternate history gives you someone to twist alternate history around and still give players something to put their feet on. We went with Gustavus Adolphus, King Gustav of Spain, who was point blank a genius. He was a military genius. He was one of the earliest significant users of mixed unit tactics. He was a master of combining cavalry and infantry tactics into surprising and very difficult to beat shapes, forms. And we had decided we were going north to Sweden. So we came back in after our break, and we'd had a couple of drinks, and we basically went, okay, Eric, we are going to Sweden. So we Metal Gear Solid our way across Sweden, only encountering people once, and as it turned out, they weren't hostile, they were just random people. So we had a nice conversation, we had a nice dinner, it was really nice. It was the only time we got caught out on our travels, and we eventually reached Sweden. This is great, except that as we're approaching Sweden, we're like we broke the distance as the crow flies into 100 mile segments and then rolled for every 100 miles. We're 200 miles away from our final destination, two rolls away, and it suddenly occurred to us we don't actually know where Persephone is. So one of the living, not undead, elves goes off to the nearest elf settlement to, I'll get to that. And the rest of us, we just turn to each other, okay, and we keep going. So eventually we're at his capital. We are making our way to his palace. He does have a palace. And he's not Christian. He's not Protestant like he was in our history. He's a pagan. But he's kind of leading an enlightenment of pagan, kind of like the Christian enlightenment, the Renaissance enlightenment, similar, but from a pagan point of view. And the end result is that he has this very open and very welcoming court. So we have no problem arranging a meeting and to actually meet up with him. And we walk in, and you know, there's people muttering because people don't like elves. It's one of the things in this game world is that there is a lot. There aren't many fey creatures, and the ones that are there are generally stigmatized. So, yeah, it was interesting. It was very interesting. We walk in, and you know, oh King Gustavus, we come to you to beg your aid in a battle which will determine the future of the human race as well as the race of elves. It was very, very drunken. It was quite drunken, I'm not going to lie. It was pretty goddamn drunk. And eventually, you know, he's like, he agrees because Gustavus Adolphus, one of the most important things to know about him historically is that he was a very rare creature in his time. He was a royal monarch who led his armed forces from the front lines. For example, when he died leading a cavalry charge. I think it was Battle Lubbets or Lunts. It's something like that. I can't quite remember. It's a while since I read up about him. I really should read up about him again. He's one of my favorite historical figures. But he's big into his whole get out there and fight the good fight, because he's been doing it his whole life. And he's very much about defending his people directly. As in, you know, if he can get a battle of champions, he'll be his own champion. That kind of person. So it doesn't take much to convince him. And his response, of course, is, have you got a plan? Oh, we have a plan. Boy, do we have a plan. We have a great plan. And the plan is this. A cannon, a chain, a lightning rod, and a frickin' harpoon. And there's a reason for this. In Greek mythology, Zeus wields a lightning bolt. That's his weapon. And it's apparently quite a common theme running through many pantheons that the head of the pantheon uses lightning in some form as a weapon. It seems to be one of those universal things that the proto-gods, whether they're the Titans or whatever, are vulnerable to damage from lightning weapons. So we assumed that the same would be true of Persephone. So the idea is we're going to harpoon her and we're going to zap her. Two problems. Number one, we don't know where she is. Number two, how exactly do we get lightning to hit a lightning rod when we need it to? Well, there's only one answer for that. We turn to the other living, still living elf, who happens to be the fastest, and go, you need to go to Mount Olympus, and you need to go to Mount Olympus now. So, yeah, we probably should have split up the party earlier. Now, I will say this, was quite unfair to Eric. Splitting the party is never a fair thing to do to a GM. It means that their planning has to be split and scattered. It's much more difficult to run a coherent, fun, entertaining campaign if the party are split. It's possible and it's doable, and if you're quite an experienced DM, you can probably do it. But it's not necessarily fair. Now, in this case, Eric had blindsided us a few times, so we were quite happy to do it. Also, we were inexperienced enough to think it was a good idea. As it turns out, it worked out quite well, because the way Eric did it was literally there were two mini scenes, and that was it. That was the party being split. Mini scene one. First elf arrives in the elf village, where he goes to the elders and requests permission to use an orb in order to communicate with all the other elf outposts and settlements to find out where Persephone is. The orb is, well, it's a palantir. The Lord of the Rings movies hadn't even been made at this stage, they hadn't even been announced. But everyone at that table were hardcore Lord of the Rings geeks. So, yeah, we went with the palantir, and there's this scene where Eric describes this character contacting the elf settlements everywhere, finding Persephone, and eventually finding that she is making her way north from Turkey, and she's making her way northwest. So she's not actually heading for Sweden, but basically she's going to do a ball of twine orbit of the earth on the ground, if that makes sense. And a ball of twine orbit will eventually cover every single segment of the earth. That's the point of a ball of twine. And she's moving fairly slowly. She's moving like maybe 10, 20 miles a day. The reason she's moving so slowly is she is literally exterminating everything that lives as she passes. She's capable of doing this. She's a god. She is damn powerful. And even if she is somewhat diminished by the, I suppose, the enlightenment of Greco-Roman religious life, she's still bloody powerful. And she's not only is she powerful, but Santa himself is powerful, and their combined power is immense. It has also become apparent that the reason Santa is doing this is to bring the gift of peace to the world. As it turns out, it's the peace of the grave. So as he is passing, he is literally, sorry, distractions, she is literally scorching the earth. There's nothing, not even viruses, left alive in her wake. It's a bad, bad thing. So that's scene one. Scene two is the second god, or the second elf, climbing Mount Olympus, and the final twisted reality step to get into Olympus itself. Olympus is a physical place in this universe, and it is at the top of Mount Olympus. If you can imagine it to be something like a much larger version of the telescope of observatories at the top of mountains, where like there's a built-out structures that support it and a whole lot. These structures exist. They just don't exist in three dimensions. They exist in several more dimensions, and they're basically invisible in this dimension. But elves, being elves, aren't quite of this dimension themselves, so they are capable of twisting into it with difficulty. So they do that. They travel. He does that, and there's this scene of him walking through Olympus, and the minor gods kind of going, "Who the fuck does this joker think he is?" And, you know, walking up, and he eventually standing in front of Zeus's throne, where Zeus is sitting there, you know, bored, and goes, "Oh, mighty Zeus, God, all father of the Greek pantheon, yada yada, I come with you in time of desperate need for all living things on this world." And Zeus listens to him, because it turns out this guy passes persuasion checks like you wouldn't fucking believe. It's literally like, passed, no problem, passed, no problem, passed, no problem, passed, no problem. So eventually Zeus goes, looks down at him and goes, and little elf, vulnerable immortal. In other words, elves are essentially immortal, but they can die. They're not invulnerable. They're two very different things. I will bring you back to your fellow heroes and wait, flying in the sky in my form of an eagle. And at the right moment, I will cast down a thunderbolt, a lightning bolt. Basically, we now have Zeus on our side. This could have gone very differently, because Zeus is a motherfucker. Zeus has a history, especially in my games, of kicking a motherfucker off of Mount Olympus and turning him into a puddle of goo at the bottom of a large crater. Yeah, I'm that kind of GM. So the party are back together, and we're marching south. In the time it's taken for the elf to get for the second elf, I wish I could remember these character names. It's driving me insane. Even the guy that I got in touch with, he doesn't remember the character names. I don't even have them. I don't even have my character sheet, which is really unusual for me. And anyway, we're all back together. In the time it took for them to get back to the court of Gustavus Adolphus, we have gathered together an army. And what an army. Considering in this timeline, Sweden is a relatively small power. It's a relatively small population. He's managed to get together roughly 12,000 men split between cavalry, infantry, and artillery. Artillery being the king of the battlefield. In this universe, Gustavus Adolphus is the originator of that. And actually, I should eat a little bit of my lunch. Yum. So, we're marching south, and we are going to channel our inner Zulus. In other words, we're going to use the horns of the buffalo. So, in other words, the horns of the buffalo are your weaker skirmishing troops. In this case, mostly cavalry and fast infantry. go around and surround, immobilizing, while the main body of your army come up through and hammer them under. Basically, hammer, anvil. The anvil in this case, the hammer I should say in this case, are the artillery. So we now know where she's coming from, and eventually we get close enough that the following day there shall be battle on that morn. Boy, is there battle on that morn, because Eric is, as a GM, he was actually really flexible, and he basically turned it into this mini war game where we had a hex grid. We had symbols for every 1,000 men, a symbol for Persephone, and basically, depending on what unit you were moving, and Gustavus, being a nice guy, gave each of us a unit to command. Depending on which unit you were commanding, you could move, I think it was 1, 3, or 5 hexes per turn, a turn equating to roughly 20 minutes of 10 to 20 minutes of battle, depending on what happened. Persephone could only move, I think it was 2 hexes per turn, so it was really important to immobilize her. Cannon don't move fast, and cannon need a stable base to fire from. This is important. These are not modern howitzers. So we're basically, we have her immobilized, and occasionally she breaks free and moves slightly forward, slightly further forward. The cannon are coming from the north to the south, and we're moving slow because they're cannon. They move 1 hex at a time, and this particular cannon is way at the back because we have 1 harpoon big enough. We have 1 lightning rod and 1 goddamn chain long enough and strong enough. We got 1 shot at this. So we're moving the loins of the buffalo forward gradually and gradually, and the cannon itself is surrounded by cavalry and heavy infantry. They're so packed in, so tight against it, that there's no possibility of Persephone seeing what's coming. This is important because it has to be a surprise. So we're moving it forward, and there are Swedish troops dying left, right, and center. Entire cavalry regiments are wiped out. Entire infantry units are just exterminated. There's these wonderful descriptions of infantrymen and cavalrymen and horses basically exploding in a haze of blood, just like gone. It's a nasty situation, but we're moving forward. We're getting there. And finally, after I think it was about 25 minutes of actual game time and these grisly, disturbing descriptions of what's happening to the infantry as they stop to fire muzzle-loaded muskets, and these weapons just bouncing, or if they do penetrate, barely penetrating and just getting her attention long enough that they get to see the musket ball evacuate from her body and just fall to the floor before they are detonated into a mist of blood and viscera. We open up, cavalry splits apart, and there's the cannon and this chain that's been trailing back for about 1/4 mile. And it's pulled taut. And this is one of the reasons there was so much cavalry. The point was, this chain is not very thick, but it is heavy. It's a long-ass chain, because we want there to be distance so that we can spread apart and not fry our own people. Luckily, Eric was pretty lenient in that respect and allowed us away with it, because we had to pull this fairly taut so that essentially, we had the lightning rod not isolated on top of a cart. So it wasn't, there was nothing conductive touching it to the ground. Chain going to the cannon, chain not touching the ground, and the cannon is on a wooden framework, again, isolated. This is going to be nasty. So there's this moment of, does she notice? She doesn't, right up until the cannon fires, and Eric describes as this huge goddess turns, and the harpoon just goes straight through her. Goes, and he describes how there's god stuff leaking from her. God stuff is complicated. We'll get into it in the future. And it's leaking from her from front and back. She's swaying, but it's not enough. You can see that she's already healing. Then Zeus, motherfucking Zeus, pulls it out of the bag. Down comes the lightning bolt. Hits the lightning rod. And there's this description of the lightning playing along the chain and all the way out along the chain to the harpoon. And yeah, she explodes. She just goes boom. It's God stuff everywhere. And in the center, as the harpoon drops and actually passes through it, there's the wisp that was Santa Claus. He tries to move, but he's not fast enough, because Zerik at this point now takes the story out of our control. This is the end game, and most GMs will do this. There will be the end of the story, and they'll tie it up in a nice, neat bow. Eric describes as Persephone gradually, over the course of about 30 seconds, reforms. She's awake, so there's no possibility of the wisp re-controlling her. Actually, when he tries, he bounces. She picks him up. She grabs him out of the air. Not being entirely physical, she just goes. And Santa is no more. No more wisp. No more danger. Except of an eternal winter. Which is fine, because then Eric goes on to say how she turns to the three undead elves and say, "Go now to Elysium. I release you from the past to which you are bound. You have achieved your ends. Go now and rest." And our bodies just disintegrate. They turn into dust. And Eric describes as we feel this moment of profound speed. And then suddenly we're surrounded by green fields and orchards, horses, dogs, cats. Anything that's ever died is there. Only sentient creatures need to have the coin to pay the ferryman. We don't even have to have that, because we're literally sent there by a god, the queen of the underworld. We go to our rest. The other two are there to witness as she turns into this cloud of god stuff, this cloud of glowing gold that then zips across the landscape so fast that even the fastest horse couldn't keep up with it. But she takes her time. For a god, she's going slow, because the point of this is to reignite belief in her, so that when she gets to Olympus, she was able to pick up Borlaeus by his throat, slam him to the ground and tell him, "You're going to let winter go. You're going to let me bring spring. And you're going to let the world come back to life. And if you don't, I'm going to rip your balls off and force feed them to you." Apparently gods have balls. Who knew? So he releases winter. Spring arrives. And we closed out the adventure by getting unbelievably drunk and falling asleep on the couches. And that was the greatest holiday adventure I ever took part in. There were others, and I will tell those stories in the future. But I really, really enjoyed that session. I really enjoyed that adventure. And even if I don't remember the names, there's enough of it. It's really clear in my mind that it's one of the highlights of my tabletop role-playing career. And I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you enjoyed my sharing this over the last few weeks. In the future, we're going to be going into kind of more vloggy, less story. Oh, excuse me. Less story driven videos of this type. I want to go into like experiences that might actually help people become either better GMs or become GMs or become better players or even just become players. I also want to cover things like how it can help you as a writer, you know. But in the meantime, I'm going to call it a day. I hope you've enjoyed this, and if you did, please like and share. Be back again soon with even more stories of adventure, when again I will ask you to stay a while and listen. In the meantime, be good, and bye for now.